With Season 11 underway, I wanted to take a look at all the exotic weapons currently in the game and attempt to rank them into a tier list for PvP. Since there's so many weapons in the exotic collection, I thought it made most sense to break them into groups. This will be the first of three videos, with this one covering all the exotic weapons that require primary ammo. In the next videos of the series, I'll cover the weapons that require special ammo and heavy ammo. Before we get into the rankings, I wanted to explain that these rankings are from the point of view of a PC player using mouse and keyboard as my primary input method. I'll try to make comments where using a controller or playing on console may affect my ranking decision otherwise, but this tier list will ultimately be determined by where I think these weapons fit for use with mouse and keyboard. This breakdown is also specifically from the lens of how useful these weapons are in PvP. Many of these are great options for PvE, but that's not what we're evaluating in this particular video. Also, at the time I'm recording this video, we're expecting a couple more exotic weapons to come out later this season. I'll try to update the pinned comment with where I would place these weapons once we have a chance to try them out. So without further ado, let's get into the rankings. By the way, the background footage from this video was almost exclusively captured during my live streams on Twitch. You can catch me live over at twitch.tv/pattycakespc. I'm going to list these weapons in the order in which they show up in the collections in-game, starting with the kinetic weapons. So our first weapon to cover is Sweet Business. The unique perk here is Payday, larger magazine, increased accuracy when firing from the hip. Picking up ammo for this weapon immediately reloads it. Sweet Business is a 600 RPM auto rifle, which is currently the best archetype for time to kill, but it's a bit of a weird weapon because it has a significant spin up time before it reaches its optimal time to kill. Once it's fully spun up though, you can absolutely delete Guardians with one of the faster TTKs in the entire game at 0.6 seconds. However, good players will punish you during that spin up period. And during that initial fire window, the time to kill is a painfully slow 1.2 seconds. In 6v6 modes, it can be really fun to use this weapon if you're able to spin it up while your teammates are in combat and then come into a room and clean up everyone quickly. I'm gonna rank this C tier because of the spin up window where you're pretty vulnerable. Next up is Sturm. It has two main perks. The first is Accomplice. Kills with this weapon fill the magazine of the equipped energy weapon from reserves. It also has Storm and Stress. Kills with Drang reload this weapon and overflow a bonus damage round into the magazine. Sturm is one of my absolute favorite 110 RPM hand cannons in the game, especially with the ornament Dream of a New World, which I really love on this weapon. It has a unique pairing with its sidearm counterpart Drang, where each kill with Drang gives you an overcharge bullet for Sturm. These overcharge bullets deal 163 headshot damage in PvP, which can often be enough to kill a weak Guardian, or at least lead to an easy cleanup kill with Drang, which then restarts the cycle over again by powering up your Sturm. Kills with Sturm also reload Drang. The cool thing about the overcharge bullets is that they stack with other damage buffs in PvP, like Empowering Rifts, Inertia Override, Well of Radiance, Weapons of Light from a Titan Bubble, or even the new Charge with Light mod, High Energy Fire. These combinations of additional damage will often provide you with a one-shot kill potential with Sturm, which is incredibly satisfying. In fact, one of my favorite builds uses this damage buff with a Warlock and Lunafaction boots to boost the range. I made a video about it a while back that you can check out on screen here as well as in the description. The downside of Sturm is that it's a 110 hand cannon, which tends to struggle a little bit in the current sandbox due to a painfully slow optimal time to kill of 1.07 seconds under normal circumstances. For that reason, I'm gonna put Sturm in the B tier. Vigilance Wing was one of the top weapons in the game back in Season 3 PvP, but it seemed to cool off a bit and have a much lower pick rate overall since then. However, in Season 11, with some changes to pulse rifles, we're seeing Vigilance Wing make a big comeback. I think it's currently one of the strongest pulses in the game. The intrinsic perk Harsh Truths grants you health regeneration and increased movement speed when a nearby ally is killed, which makes it a great weapon for winning clutch situations. The other perk, Last Stand, also improves weapon performance and greatly increases your recovery when you're the last living member of a fire team. With an optimal time to kill of just 0.77 seconds requiring only 2 bursts, it's one of the faster killing primary weapons in the game without requiring a damage buff. When I tested this gun out for the video, I was able to regularly drop 50 plus Elim games without even really paying much attention to what I was doing. It's just a slaying machine and it feels really easy to use. I also love the ornament Vigil for Saint 14, which has one of the nicest wide open weapon sights in the entire game. It makes it super easy to track targets. I think Vigilance Wing deserves a spot in the S tier. Rat King is one of those weapons that gets better depending on how many teammates use it with you. The intrinsic perk Rat Pack allows the fully automatic weapon to become stronger when nearby allies have it equipped. This stacks up to 6 times and this effect buffs the rate of fire. It also grants you a period of invisibility when you get a kill and reload the weapon. Facing a full team of players using Rat King can actually be really frustrating. The rate of fire when Rat King is fully buffed up with Rat Pack times 6 can get you absolutely melted. And the exotic catalyst also grants additional aim assist and recoil direction, as well as triggering that health regen as soon as you reload after a kill, in addition to that normal invisibility. Even by itself, I think that it's a fairly strong weapon, especially with the catalyst. I'm going to rank this in the B tier when using it solo, with the possibility of maybe moving to A or even S tier when you have enough teammates using it with you to fully charge it up. The Mida multi-tool is one of those unfortunate casualties of the state of scout rifles in PvP right now. I think in general, one of the things that holds scouts back is that the typical engagement distances of most fights just don't benefit scouts. Most of the time you're better off with a pulse rifle, auto rifle, or a hand cannon. Mida's intrinsic perk gives it faster movement speed as well as the ability to see your radar while aiming down sights. It has an optimal time to kill of 0.9 seconds, which is fairly slow in the current sandbox, and also requires 3 headshots and 1 body shot. In my testing with Mida for this video, I found myself constantly leaving enemies with just a tiny bit of health left. The catalyst also doesn't help it much either, only providing Outlaw, which also recently got nerfed. The default reload speed of the multi-tool is already really fast, so I don't understand why the catalyst focused on reload. It would make the gun much more interesting if you got kill clip or rampage or some other damage buff with the catalyst to improve that time to kill a little bit. The one bright spot of the multi-tool is that you have really good movement potential while you're strafing. However, you'll need to stay strafing for quite a while because it takes a long time to get kills with this weapon. It makes me a bit sad that the Mida feels so out of touch in this current sandbox because it was one of my favorite weapons in Destiny 1. Hopefully it will get some love in a future patch. For now, I'm going to rank it in the D tier. Crimson is an interesting hybrid between a pulse rifle and a hand cannon. It gets its DNA from the old Destiny 1 exotic pulse rifle Red Death, which was another one of my favorite weapons. The intrinsic perk Cruel Remedy allows kills with this weapon to heal the wielder, and precision kills also refill the magazine. Crimson has an optimal time to kill of 0.87 seconds, which is the same as a 140 RPM hand cannon. It's somewhere in the middle of the pack as far as TTK is concerned. My main issue with this gun is that it has the downsides of both a pulse rifle and a hand cannon, while not really receiving the benefits of either type of weapon. The main strength of a hand cannon is that you can peak shoot to deal huge chunks of damage and then retreat to cover until you're ready to fire again. It's one of the reasons that hand cannons are nearly always at the top of the Destiny meta for high level play. Crimson shoots a 3-round burst, which hurts your ability to peak shoot since you need to be exposed during that entire 3-round burst window in order to deal full damage. The upside of most pulse rifles is that they tend to have pretty good range with minimal damage drop off, but in this area, Crimson acts more like a hand cannon where it starts to see damage drop off around 27 meters. I do find the weapon pretty fun to use for casual 6v6 play, especially when you can start chaining together headshot kills and get your health and ammo back at the same time. For competitive play though, I think it falls a little bit behind some other options. I'm going to rank it in the B tier. Next up is the Jade Rabbit. Similar to the Mida multi-tool, the Jade Rabbit struggles currently by nature of being a scout rifle in a sandbox that just doesn't really favor this weapon type. Jade Rabbit has an optimal time to kill of just 0.8 seconds, which is the same as a 150 RPM hand cannon like the Dire Promise, but it has a very punishing body shot time to kill of 2.0 seconds, so you really need to land your headshots. The exotic perk Fate of All Fools allows you to chain body shots to gain bonus damage on your next precision shot and return ammo to the magazine. However, I believe this perk is currently bugged, and hopefully Bungie can fix it soon. I'm going to rank Jade Rabbit in the C tier. The Huckleberry is a 750 RPM SMG with the exotic perk Ride the Bull, which increases the rate of fire and recoil while holding down the trigger. Kills with this weapon reload a portion of the magazine. At base, the Huckleberry has an optimal time to kill of 0.67 seconds, which is already extremely fast, and when fully spun up, that number shrinks to 0.53 seconds according to the Mercury's Massive Breakdown Weapon Stats spreadsheet. This is an incredible Destiny 2 resource, by the way. If you haven't seen it yet, I would highly recommend checking it out. I'll link to it in the description. With stacks of Rampage, the Huckleberry really starts to shred in PvP. It's incredibly fun to use. However, the main drawback of this weapon is that the range stat of 53 is really poor. In testing, it seemed to start damage drop off around 16 meters. My max range hard truths of the same archetype doesn't experience damage drop off until 24 meters for comparison's sake. I think this weapon is very strong in the current sandbox, but only at very close range. It really starts to struggle when you're further away from your enemy. I'm going to rank it in the B tier. The Suros Regime is one of my absolute favorite weapons in PvP currently. The exotic perk Spinning Up increases rate of fire while holding down the trigger, and the perk Suros Legacy allows the bottom half of each magazine to deal bonus damage and grants a chance to return health on kill. While using the spinning up choice, it has an initial time to kill of 0.7 seconds at 600 RPM, and then it jumps to a 0.6 second time to kill at 720 RPM, and finally a 0.47 second time to kill at 900 RPM. When the Suros is fully spun up, it absolutely melts targets like not much else in the game. To add to this, the Exotic Catalyst bumps the recoil direction to 100, which makes it feel fantastic to fire. It's very stable and vertical, and it also increases the chance for kills to regen your health. In the hands of a talented player, Suros is a downright scary weapon to come across, especially when it's spinning up to those faster speeds. The only real downside is that the magazine is fairly small compared to other auto rifles, and the range is okay, but not amazing. Overall though, I think Suros deserves a top spot in the S tier. Cerberus Plus One is another interesting hybrid weapon that essentially combines a shotgun with an auto rifle. I have a similar criticism to Crimson, where I feel like the gun does each job in a somewhat mediocre way, although it's still pretty fun to use in game modes like 6v6 control. The exotic perk here is Four-Headed Dog, where it shoots erratic bullets from all gun barrels at the same time. This results in a fire pattern that's essentially the same as a shotgun. Up close, you're likely to hit most of your bullets, but from further away, the likelihood of landing your shots gets worse and worse, depending on how far away you are. In close quarters, Cerberus kills really fast, with an optimal time to kill of 0.67 seconds. However, every few meters further away you are from the target, the time to kill gets slower and slower until the gun becomes completely ineffective. The Exotic Catalyst allows you to engage an alternate fire mode that concentrates the bullets in a tighter spread pattern, however it also destroys the range for bullet damage drop off, and it makes it really rough to use outside of extremely close quarters. In my testing with Cerberus for this video, I found it to be really fun to use, but not really all that effective compared to most other top weapons. I'm gonna rank this in the C tier. I think you're generally better off with a different auto rifle. Wishender's exotic perk Queen's Wrath highlights enemies behind walls while aiming down sights with a fully drawn bow. This wall hack effect is very powerful and it can be used for picking up kills and getting info on where a team is moving, especially in modes like Trials of Osiris. However, the bow itself is pretty mediocre in my opinion. It has a painfully low draw time of 792 milliseconds, which is one of the longest of all bows in the game, so even if you hit your shot, you really have to switch to a different weapon to clean up the kill. It also has the lowest aim assist stat of any of the exotic bows. I'm gonna rank this bow down in the D tier. I think if you're using it for an information play in a team with really good communication, it could move up a couple tiers, but for solo play, I think there's plenty of better options. Malfeasance is a 180 RPM hand cannon with the exotic perk Explosive Shadow, which lets you shoot tainted slugs that burrow into the enemy. Stacking enough slugs causes them all to explode. For PvP, that number is 5 slugs, which means that it has essentially infinite range as long as you can hit your 5 slugs on the target. 180 RPM hand cannons are not in the greatest place in the sandbox right now. They have an optimal time to kill of 1 second flat, which makes it pretty tough to compete with something like an auto rifle or a 150 RPM hand cannon. However, the strength of Malfeasance is the unique ability with the slugs. It actually grows in strength with more fire team members using the same weapon, similar to Rat King. If you hit an enemy with 3 slugs and your buddy hits him with 2 slugs, that 5 total will result in an explosion and land you guys the kill. This is particularly effective against supers. If you and some friends are all hitting the super with your slug rounds, it will go down fast. I'm gonna put Malfeasance in the C tier for solo play, with the potential to move it up to B or maybe even A tier when used together in a group and team shotting. Ace of Spades is a 140 RPM hand cannon that is absolutely stacked with perks. Its main exotic perk is Memento Mori. Reloading after a kill loads the magazine with a few extra damage bullets, grants radar while aiming down sights. Those extra damage bullets hit hard in PvP. A normal headshot with Ace will deal 70 damage, while a Memento Mori shot will deal 90. This means that you can kill with one headshot and two body shots within its effective range at all resilience levels. In my hand cannon ranking tier list from about a year ago, I had Ace ranked in the S tier, but since then hand cannons were hit with a pretty substantial range nerf, and Ace seemed to feel that one especially hard. Damage falloff now starts around 28 meters normally, and oddly enough it seems even worse at only 26 meters when Memento Mori is active. It just doesn't have the range it used to experience. On top of all that, it's a 140 RPM hand cannon, so it's going to lose to 150 RPM hand cannons in a pure duel if you're both hitting all of your headshots. So I think Ace is still a great choice overall and certainly a viable weapon, but I'm going to drop it down to A tier for this particular list. The last word's exotic perk is Fanfire. This weapon fires full auto. Hipfire shots deal bonus precision damage while increasing reload speed and accuracy. The Last Word was far and away the best hand cannon in the game until Season 10, when it received a huge rework. Now it's essentially a hipfire mandatory weapon, and it's much more difficult to use on mouse and keyboard. The recent buff to hipfire grip did help The Last Word quite a bit, and it made it feel a lot better on mouse and keyboard. However, it's certainly still not as consistently lethal as it was prior to Season 10. While hipfiring, it has a blistering fast 0.53 second time to kill if you're able to hit all headshots, but that number climbs up to 0.8 seconds if you need to aim down sights. I found in particular using The Last Word with Lucky Pants on a hunter takes advantage of that accuracy buff, and it really seems to help the weapon. For console and controller players, The Last Word is one of the best primary weapons in the game, and it feels very sticky. For mouse and keyboard players, on the other hand, it's better than it used to be in Season 10, but I think there are still some better options with more consistency. I'm going to put this in the B tier if you're able to use it with hipfire, and maybe C tier if you feel the need to ADS to hit your shots. Thorn, in my opinion, is one of the best hand cannons in the game currently. Its exotic perk is Mark of the Devourer. Rounds pierce targets and deal damage over time. Kills with this weapon leave behind remnants. Thorn has a few major things going right for it. First of all, it's a 150 RPM hand cannon, which is the fastest archetype time to kill at 0.8 seconds, other than The Last Word or an Overcharge Sturm. The damage over time effect mitigates some of that range lost to the recent hand cannon range nerf a few months ago, and it also delays your enemy from healing, which can give you a really huge advantage in a duel. If you do manage to get a kill and pick up that remnant orb to get the Thorn perk, your magazine is partially reloaded and your damage over time is bumped up to 7 damage per tick, which really starts to eat away at the enemies and allows you to 2-tap guardians up to 60 resilience. When situations really line up for you with Thorn, you can sometimes go on some crazy killing sprees with several kills before needing to reload. The only real downside I see is that there's a fairly small magazine and only 9 bullets, and it does lack an Icarus mod for in-air accuracy like you'd normally have with a legendary hand cannon. I'm going to put Thorn in the S tier as a top pick in PvP. Outbreak Perfected has two exotic perks that work in tandem. The first is the Corruption Spreads. This weapon creates Siva Nanite Swarms on rapid hits and precision kills. It also has Parasitism. This weapon does more damage to enemies based on the number of Siva Nanites that attach to them. The Outbreak Catalyst also increases this Nanite damage. I think this effect is super cool, and it's really fun to see all the Nanites attacking enemies if you land your crit hits, but it's really not all that impactful in PvP. The core archetype of this weapon is a little bit lacking, being a 450 RPM pulse rifle. The optimal time to kill is 0.87 seconds, which is sort of the middle of the pack, and it doesn't really keep pace with something like a Vigilance Wing. However, Outbreak is pretty stable to shoot, and I do enjoy using it. Something about it feels really consistent and easy to land shots with. I'm going to place this one in the B tier. It's a solid option, but not quite at the same level as some of the top weapons for competitiveness. Bad Juju's exotic perk is String of Curses. Kills refill the magazine, increase damage for a short duration, and grant super energy based on the strength of String of Curses, fires in full auto. Bad Juju struggles a bit from the same issues as Outbreak. It has an archetype that is basically middle of the road. However, the damage buff you get from String of Curses can improve the time to kill slightly, depending on the number of stacks that you have. Here's how the damage ramps up in PvP. At base, you get 25 damage for a headshot. With 1 stack, that's 28 damage, 2 stacks is 30 damage, 3 stacks is 33 damage, 4 stacks is 35 damage, and 5 stacks is 38 damage. I think one of the big benefits of Bad Juju compared to other pulse rifles is the inclusion of the perk Hipfire Grip, which recently got a buff. Bad Juju actually feels really nice to hipfire. It's a pretty effective way to use the weapon, however, in reality, I think if you're going to be hipfiring that much, that also maybe means that you should be using a weapon that's better suited for those kind of ranges, like an SMG. I'm going to put this one in the B tier, right next to Outbreak. Lumina has two main perks that work together. The first is Noble Rounds. Kills with this weapon leave behind remnants. Absorbing a remnant converts your hip-fired shot into an ally-seeking noble round and partially refills the magazine. This coincides with its other perk, Blessing of the Sky. Using a noble round on an ally heals them and grants both you and them a damage bonus for a short duration. Lumina is another 150 RPM hand cannon, so it has a fast 0.8 second time to kill. It also has a really nice weapon sight, and overall it feels like a pretty solid hand cannon. Its strength really comes from being able to play well with a team. If you can always be aware of your teammates' positions and give them the buff to heal them and also give yourself that extra damage buff, Lumina can be really great. It also opens up some fun combinations like using a high impact sniper rifle to one-shot body shot enemies up to 50 resilience when you have Blessing of the Sky activated. However, strictly for solo play, it's essentially just a good hand cannon. I'm going to rank this in the A tier, with a note that it could be S tier for players who are hyper aware of your teammates' locations and able to take full advantage of the toolkit as a support weapon. Monte Carlo's main exotic perk is the Monte Carlo method. Dealing damage with this weapon reduces your melee cooldown and grants a chance to fully charge your melee ability with each kill. This coincides with its other perk, Markov Chain. This weapon gains increased damage from melee kills and kills with this weapon. Melee kills grant ammo for this weapon. Markov Chain here works essentially like the perk Swashbuckler. It stacks up to 5 times for max damage. Here's how the damage ramps up. At base, you deal 26 damage for a headshot. With 1 stack, you deal 27. 2 stacks is 29. 3 stacks is 31. 4 stacks is 32. And finally, with 5 stacks, you deal 34 damage, which is the same as having Kill Clip. For Warlocks and Titans who don't have the ability to dodge to get a melee back, Monte Carlo has some really good value. It's a 600 RPM auto rifle, which means that it has a 0.7 second time to kill at base, and with Markov Chain stacked all the way up to 5 times, you can kill even faster. Overall, I think Monte Carlo is a solid weapon and it's very fun to use. Something about it feels a little bit less consistent to me compared to some other top autos like the Suros or the Gnawing Hunger. I'm going to put this in the A tier with a note that it could become S tier depending on how valuable your charged melee ability is in your particular build. Okay, let's move on to our energy slot exotics. First up here is the Fighting Lion. Fighting Lion's exotic perk is Delayed Gratification. Grenade projectiles bounce off surfaces, hold fire, and release to detonate. This is a really difficult one for me to rank because Fighting Lion acts more like a special weapon than a primary weapon. It's incredibly powerful and effective, but it's difficult to run around with Fighting Lion all by itself, and it pretty heavily relies on pairing it with another weapon to be most effective. My favorite way to use the Fighting Lion is to take a page from Cammy Cake's playbook and use the Snipe Lion combo. This is where you launch a grenade at an enemy to weaken them and go for a body shot with a high impact sniper to clean up the kill. This in turn reloads Fighting Lion automatically and you're ready to repeat the cycle. The exotic catalyst also grants the perk Chimera, where firing Fighting Lion grants a brief period of increased handling and accuracy to kinetic and power weapons. Fun fact, this perk is triggered even when the Fighting Lion doesn't have any ammo to shoot. The biggest strength of this weapon is that you can essentially get free damage into enemies behind cover. Since you're effectively getting a special weapon that only requires primary ammo, I'm going to put this in the B tier with the understanding that you really need to pair it with another weapon to get the most out of it. Sunshot has two main exotic perks. The first is Sunburn. This weapon fires explosive rounds and highlights targets that take damage from the Sunshot. The other one is Sunblast. Targets killed with Sunshot explode in solar energy. Sunshot has been one of my favorite weapons since Destiny 2 was first released. It's only gotten better now that it finally has 12 bullets in the magazine and a catalyst that grants extra range and stability. Its explosive rounds also help to mitigate some of that range loss due to the recent hand cannon range nerf. The explosive damage from getting kills with Sunshot is pretty noticeable, and occasionally you will see some pretty funny chain kills where you kill one guardian whose explosion nets you a few extra kills on some low health enemies. Sunshot also has a very fast reload and overall some pretty good stats. The one main drawback of Sunshot to me is that its aim assist stat is pretty low, which can make it a little bit difficult to land shots. Also, the combination of its sights and the explosive rounds occasionally makes it a little bit tough for me to track targets. Overall though, I think Sunshot is a top pick for exotic primaries and belongs in the S tier. Graviton Lance has two exotic perks that work together. The first is Black Hole. Second shot of a burst rips a hole through space-time, doing high damage and recoil with no falloff. The other one is Cosmology. Kills with this weapon cause enemy targets to detonate and spawn void projectiles that track targets. Back in Season 3, Graviton was basically the meta primary weapon. It was incredibly powerful and used in almost every single match. However, when the time to kill was globally changed and weapons like snipers, shotguns, fusions, and breach grenade launchers moved into the special ammo slot, it seemed like Graviton was kind of left behind. It currently has the worst time to kill of any pulse rifle at 1.0 seconds. On top of that, this time to kill requires you to hit the crit shots on each of your black hole shots, which is that delayed bullet that comes out second in the 2-round burst. Against players who move really well, this can be tough to do, and the time to kill gets atrociously bad if you start missing those black hole shots. When testing the gun for this video, I actually had a lot of fun using it. It was a big hit of nostalgia from earlier seasons. It's very fun dealing damage without worrying about any falloff range, but the shots are a little bit difficult to hit at extreme ranges where that really starts to come into play. The Cosmology explosion effect is really fun too, and it's pretty cool to see those chain kills come together, similar to Sunshot. However, I can't in good faith rank this weapon very high due to its very poor time to kill. I'm going to put this one in the C tier. Skyburner's Oath has the exotic perk Slug Rifle. This weapon lobs large, explosive seeking slugs when you're firing from the hip. When you're aiming down sights, the slugs travel fast and straight with higher damage and a lower rate of fire. Okay, I have to level with you. This gun is really, really bad, but it's also one of the funniest weapons to use in the game. I had a blast trying to get footage for this video when I was on stream using this weapon. The hip-fired slug rounds are really interesting to use, and sometimes you can get some pretty funny kills with them. If you somehow manage to hit all of your shots while hip-firing, the time to kill is actually pretty good at 0.8 seconds, but in ADS mode, that time to kill rises to 1.0 seconds, and it feels very slow. This gun is pretty funny, especially if you want to use it in an AC-130 gunship type build, but it's definitely not very competitive in my book. I'm gonna have to go F tier with this one, but I did actually have a lot of fun playing around with it as a meme. Risk Runner has two exotic perks that work in tandem. The first one is Arc Conductor. When taking arc damage, this weapon becomes more powerful and resists incoming arc damage. Kills extend the time in this overcharged state. It also has Superconductor. When Arc Conductor is active, shots fired have the chance to become Chain Lightning and return ammo. Risk Runner has been one of my favorite weapons to use since Vanilla D2. The Chain Lightning effect is crazy fun in PvE, and it actually works pretty well in PvP too. You can actually proc Arc Conductor by inflicting arc damage on yourself with a grenade, which then also gives you that arc damage shield. Its base archetype is a 900 RPM SMG, which gives it a 0.73 second time to kill, and that drops to 0.67 seconds when the Arc Conductor perk is active. The Exotic Catalyst gives it a nice range bump as well. Used within close quarters, I think this gun is actually A tier because you can proc the initial Arc Conductor by yourself, and if you happen to be playing against a team using a lot of arc damage sources, this gun might even jump up to S tier in my book. Hardlight's main exotic perk for PvP purposes is Volatile Light. Rounds fired from this weapon have reduced damage falloff, overpenetrate targets, and ricochet off hard surfaces. Projectile damage increases after bounce. At the start of Season 10, this gun was really popular, to the point where the Destiny community screamed for a nerf and it got adjusted, and probably a necessary one at that. Even after the nerf, I still think Hardlight is a top pick. It's a 600 RPM auto rifle, which means it has a 0.7 second optimal time to kill. It also has fantastic stats across the board and great range with minimal damage drop off. It has a huge magazine at 49 rounds and an aim assist stat of 100. The bouncing rounds are also very effective for cleaning up kills on guardians who duck behind cover. The exotic catalyst gives it extra stability, which also really helps the weapon. There's really not much bad to say about this gun right now. I'm gonna put it in the S tier. Polaris Lance's exotic perk is the perfect fifth. Precision hits return ammo to the mag. Landing 4 precision hits loads a delayed solar explosive round for your next shot. Polaris Lance is one of my favorite weapons to use in PvP, but unfortunately it struggles a bit by nature of being a scout rifle. Similar to the Jade Rabbit, it's also a 150 RPM scout rifle, so it has a time to kill of 0.8 seconds. When you land your headshots and charge up that perfect fifth shot, you can make some really cool plays, but in close range I find it pretty difficult to land shots with. I think on longer range maps, this is one of my favorite weapons to use. The Catalyst provides Firefly, which is pretty fun too. However, it is a scout rifle, and those feel a little bit tough to use in many situations in PvP right now. I'm gonna put this one in the C tier. Trinity Ghoul has two main exotic perks. The first one is Split Electron, fires an arrow that splits when released. Aiming down sights and fully drawing the bow decreases the spread. Where this gets really fun is the second perk, Lightning Rod. Precision kills grant the next shot chain lightning capabilities. This bow was pretty much a joke in PvP until Season 11 when its exotic catalyst became available in-game. This allows kills with any source of arc damage while holding the bow out to proc the Lightning Rod perk. This means that if you have your bow out and you tag someone and then you throw an arc grenade or use a charged melee and get the kill, your next arrow will be charged and you can hit with chain lightning. It's incredibly fun to use this effect in both PvE and PvP. When testing for this video, I found that the first kill was pretty difficult to get unless I was using the ADS function of the bow due to that arrow spread effect. But once you get one kill, you can really go on some pretty fun sprees. I'm gonna put this bow in the C tier. I think it's very, very fun, but not really all that competitive, mostly because of that spread arrow effect. Laymanok's exotic perk is Poison Arrows. Arrows fired quickly after a full draw become poison arrows. Precision hits with poison arrows spread poison to nearby enemies. Laymanok is an interesting weapon to rank. By itself, it's a very good weapon, but not necessarily going to get you a ton of kills alone. However, if you treat it more like a fighting lion, and you use it in conjunction with your other weapon, by quick swapping back and forth, it's incredibly lethal. One of the most frustrating things to play against in PvP is a player skilled with a Lay Monarch, Hand Cannon, Quick Draw combo. The time to kill feels nearly instantaneous. Flame Monarch is even stronger than a normal bow with this combo because of the poison it spreads on a full draw. This effect can delay health regeneration just like Thorn, which is always a powerful effect. I also find the weapon sights on Flame Monarch to be one of the best of any bow. It's very easy to see your target, which is something that often bothers me with other bows. I'm going to rank this bow in the A tier, assuming it's paired with another weapon like a hand cannon. Terrabuzz's two exotic perks work in tandem. The first is Ravenous Beast. This weapon stores power when dealing or receiving damage. Once full, hold to reload and unleash the beast. This ties in with the other perk, Bottomless Appetite. Dealing continuous damage extends the duration of Ravenous Beast. Terrabuzz is one of the most fun guns to use in casual 6v6 play. It absolutely shreds with the Ravenous Beast perk activated at an insane time to kill of 0.33 seconds. However, it has one main drawback that really holds back the slaying potential of this weapon. You lose progress on Ravenous Beast whenever you swap weapons. This means that you need to have Terraba out at all times when you're trying to build up this charge. You actually even lose progress towards Ravenous Beast by pulling your ghost out. It feels very restrictive in PvP to not be able to switch to a sniper or a shotgun without losing progress towards the perk. I think this makes it much more suited towards casual 6v6 play than it does for competitive modes. I'm going to rank this in the B tier overall, but if I was able to switch weapons and retain that Ravenous Beast progression, I think I'd immediately move this to S tier. Symmetry also has two perks that work in tandem. The first is Revolution. This weapon fires full auto. Hold reload to swap to Arc Seeker mode. Arc Seekers track towards combatants you target. This ties in with the other perk, Dynamic Charge. Precision hits build up dynamic charge. Swapping to Arc Seeker mode increases the damage and partially reloads the magazine based on the number of charges. So Symmetry is a really interesting weapon. Its lethality essentially grows depending on how patient you are while loading up that dynamic charge perk. At 4 stacks, you can 3-tap Guardians with Revolution, and at 7 stacks, you can actually 2-tap. These Revolution Arc Seekers are like homing missiles that are very easy to hit your target with. However, I personally don't love how the gun feels in its normal mode. It's a 260 RPM scout with a 0.93 second time to kill, and a pretty terrible range stat at only 28. I'm going to rank this in the C tier. It's fun to use, but I think overall there's a lot stronger weapons around, since it requires quite a bit of setup to become good. Devil's Ruin has a main exotic perk called Close the Gap. Variable trigger. Press and release to fire individual shots. Hold to charge up a high-powered staggering laser. The fully charged laser is very fun to use in PvP. I had a blast using this weapon when I was trying to get the background footage for this video. However, that charge time is going to be very difficult to pull off against higher level players. I feel like this weapon is mostly good for just casual 6v6 play, and it's not nearly as effective against players who will challenge you while you're trying to charge up that laser. If you do manage to pull off the full charge time though, you're going to absolutely melt your target. I'm going to put this one in the C tier. And finally we have Tommy's Matchbook. The exotic perk here is Ignition Trigger. Sustained fire with this weapon overheats it, increasing the damage but also burning the user. Tommy's Matchbook is a very fun weapon to use in PvP. It has some of the best hipfire and in-air accuracy hipfire of any auto rifle that I've used, which is really cool because it mitigates some of that move speed penalty that you normally experience while aiming down sights. The Ignition Trigger perk is interesting because it does increase the damage pretty substantially from 21 per headshot to 31 per headshot, but the self damage is pretty severe, so you need to be careful not to activate this too much when you have multiple enemies around you that can put in some damage and lead to your death. It's a 720 RPM auto rifle, so its base time to kill is a respectable 0.77 seconds, and it also has a gigantic magazine size, so you can get quite a few kills before needing to reload. I found when using this gun with the hipfire mode, my playstyle became a little bit too aggressive, and often it got me into big trouble, but it's definitely really fun to use. I'm going to put this one in the B tier. So I hope you enjoyed this video, it was certainly a ton of work, so if you made it this far, I'd really appreciate a thumbs up rating. Let me know in the comments if there's any weapons that you'd rank differently. I'd love to hear what you think. In the next video for the series, I'll be reviewing the exotic special weapons, so be sure to subscribe and turn on your notifications so you don't miss that one. As I mentioned in the beginning, the background footage from this video was captured mostly during my Twitch streams. You can catch me live over at twitch.tv/pattycakespc. We also have a fantastic Discord community which you should join if you want to make some new friends to play games with. There's a link in the description to check it out. And finally, I take ideas for videos like this one from my Twitter account. You can follow me over at pattycakesgg. That's all for now. Catch you guys next time.